Kathy Utiger, I'm your chairman, and welcome to everybody today. Is there anybody here who's new to Tortoise Group? Never been here before? Welcome. Are you possibly, do you have a new tortoise, or?
I collect water turtles, but I do love turtles of all kinds, so I'm here to research and learn more.
Wonderful.
Happy to help.
I see an adoption in our future. Let's hope. Well, I see that we have someone who has arrived that I'd like to introduce, and this is our new consultant, Lisa Mayo. And Lisa's going to... Would you like to say just a word? Okay. And as I said, we have this big effort going, and we're going to work with Lisa. She's going to guide us through this process, and we're excited.
Well, I'm excited to be here. This is a great group, and I'm very excited to be working with Kathy and everyone. And really what our task is to just put together the goals, objectives of this group, which has been around for quite a while. I've lived in Vegas 28 years, and I dealt with the tortoises in very different capacities through my business and different things that I have done here in Las Vegas. So I'm excited to be here. I think it's going to be a very enlightening, good effort to get this organization where Kathy wants to be. This is her vision. And I'm really here to facilitate, and I'm pleased to be part of this effort. Thank you for letting me come to this. And I did have one turtle, a tortoise, sometime that I fostered. I have five kids. I wasn't sure which was more important, the five kids or the tortoise at that time, because I wasn't used to it, but it was a good experience. My kids loved it. So thank you very much. And if you have any questions, let me know.
Thank you, Lisa. Doesn't work. There. I want to talk a little bit about hot summer behavior. Let's see if it'll work now. So just a couple of things I wanted to go through. As I do each meeting, go through kind of behavior that's going on at this time, at this season.
So
coping with the extreme heat, rain, vacation, and hatchling. So what's happening now? When it's really hot, which this week is supposed to be, is historically the hottest week of the summer, and it hasn't been, has it? We had one hot day and blessedly a few others. But when it's very, very hot, gets to be, 115 outside, the tortoise has to come out early, and he doesn't have very much time. In the wild, the tortoise has about an hour and a half to do everything that a tortoise needs to do. Sorry, it has to be that loud. So he emerges earlier, and when it's really sunny, he can't stay out very long.
So there's
not as much time for you to interact with him or find him and play with him as there is, say, in the spring when they're out all day. They may be eating less, but some aren't. And the new mega diet has changed that, because I hear they're just chowing down on that stuff. Everybody's going, yes, which is a good thing. So even if they're eating less and you're not home, they may adjust to your schedule. So they'll come out when you're there so that you can serve them. But there's still not as much time to browse. So the sun is out in your yard, if you have a sunny yard, and the tortoise can only be out for a while because, boom, they get too hot and they've got to escape from the heat. And so they got to go in the burrow or under whatever bush or under the sign or wherever they hide out. And of course, the flowers aren't as big now either, or as abundant. So there isn't as much fun browsing as there used to be in the spring. Now, another couple of things that happen during this extreme heat, if it's extreme, and it hasn't been this year, is estivation. So if it's this particular week and then the next week into August, often are just killers. And so the tortoise just stays in his burrow. And then I get the emails, oh, I'm so worried, where's my tortoise? Is he dead? I can't see him. And really, the only thing he's doing is he's being really, really smart, and he's conserving his energy, because for him to come out, now let's see, the average temperature is about like 90-something now, so 95, let's say, which is already kind of at the upper limit of where he's really comfortable. So he comes out, it's already 110 out, so in the sun it's 140. He gets hot really fast, he's got to get out of the sun, and what has he accomplished? Not very much, but even so, he's got to spend a lot of energy cooling off. So instead of doing that, just stays inside and chills out till things get better. Hopefully they get better. We're on the downside now, I think. Now, this other thing that they do at this time of year is sleep outside. So this burrow thing, the burrow's heating up, because our average temperature is getting hotter and hotter and hotter until right now we're reaching the peak. So the earth temperature lags because it's heating up. So back in that early hot spell, my burrow was 87, and I haven't measured it lately, but it's probably 90-something now. So it's been heating up. So let's say it's 110 outside, and your tortoise goes in the burrow, and the burrow is 98, or maybe more if it's only got a little bit of insulation on the top. And then the temperature outside plummets to 90. So by 9 or 10 o'clock, it's gotten quite a lot cooler. And the tortoise can sense that and says, ha-ha, it's going to be better outside. So the tortoise leaves the burrow and goes outside. Now, that happens at my house around 9 or 10 o'clock. It hasn't happened yet this year. I think he's staying in his burrow. And then he sleeps outside all night so that he can lower his body temperature. Then around daybreak, go back in the burrow, and then come out at normal tortoise time. Now, does anyone else have this happen?
Yes.
Yes, a lot of people? So don't be surprised if your tortoise is wandering around doing things that you wouldn't expect. Now, it's been raining, and we can hope for some more today. And people often say, well, my tortoise has plenty of water. Why is he coming out and drinking from the little puddles? Well, that's one of his basic strategies for survival. You know, in the wild, they'll smell the rain, they'll know a place where water will pool, and they'll go there and wait and hope that it rains and that they can get a drink. Well, there's Tad outside getting a drink from the patio when he doesn't need to. And he even came out in January. I didn't know he did that. But I inadvertently tracked him outside his burrow because I covered it with a tarp, and in the morning there he was, trapped outside. And I had no idea he came out in the middle of brumation when it rained. That's a really strong urge to do that. There's my burrow when it's covered, but see, I had that down over the front. Mm-hmm. In the middle of the night, I said, oh God, it's been raining and raining and raining and raining for weeks. I should get up and cover this. I covered it 2 in the morning, and there he was at 7, trapped. Oh God, poor boy. Well, I've got a lot of dirt on my burrow, and I'm not concerned about it flooding. It's never gotten wet inside. But when there's a really heavy rain, if I think about it, I go out and cover it. and especially if we have a period of rain, so that the earth is going to get real soggy, and, you know, eventually it'll get wet in there. So I don't want that to happen, and once in a while I actually go out there and cover it up. What you don't want to do is leave the cover on there, because it'll turn into that greenhouse effect. It's plastic, and it'll get steamy in there as soon as it starts heating up, so you want to take that off and let the burrow breathe and do its wonderful thing that it does. You want to soak your tortoise every now and then, however long they want to be in there. Tad doesn't like to be in there, but I make him go in there anyway, every now and then to get a drink. And he may, a tortoise that's real thirsty may drink for 20 or 30 minutes or more. Just stick their head under the water, so don't be worried. They're fine, they can hold their breath. Dr. Comstetter told us for 2 or 3 hours. So they're just getting the water they need and enjoying it. And in this hot weather, that's a good idea. It'll help flush the bladder and the kidneys and everything, especially if they have just been getting water from their food. Now, how about vacations? What do you do? Well, the best thing to do is to have trained your tortoise how to browse and to take care of itself in its habitat and leave it at home. I often get calls saying, can I board my tortoise at somebody's house? Well, there are a couple of problems with that. One is disease transmission. You don't know if their tortoise has something or if your tortoise has something. And of course, if they were together in a habitat, well, if it was two girls, they might get along. Two boys would fight, and of course, a boy and a girl would mate. So plan ahead and have a way for your tortoise to browse and to know its habitat and to be able to get along without you. And then find somebody who can just pop by and maybe give it some food or not, but just check to see that things are okay. And then what we have coming up is hatchlings. And even though I hate to think about it, I know that there are hatchlings coming all over, thousands and thousands of them in backyards. And so if you have hatchlings coming, even if you've separated your male and your female, plan now to build a little habitat. You can use this thing.
For a hatchling burrow, you can use two of these. Put them together, one this way. Fill it up with dirt like this. See how it's hatchling shaped. Put a big mound of dirt over it, and there you've got a hatchling. This is a rake roof tile, and they're available. We've got a on our website where to get those.
You can build it in an enclosure, and we have some directions on our website for how to do that. Be sure to refer anybody to us if you're going to be giving them a little one, because otherwise it's going to end up in a terrarium and they're going to give it lettuce and then it'll turn into this really sad thing and die, which is what happens to, unfortunately, most of the hatchlings. They really have a very sad life. However, they don't have to have, and we could teach them how to take care of a little guy. Hatching is going to occur sometime late August, early September, and some of them even eking along into October. And some people find them in spring and didn't know they had them, or I don't know, maybe they were even underground all that time. We'll talk more about hatching next time. But the point is, get ready now or start looking for prospective adopters. And here's, of course, the reason. They're just so adorable. You want 47 of them. Well, don't you look at, they've all got different personalities and they're so cute And you just think, oh, I could handle five of them. But as you know, though, that isn't what happens. It turns out to be a very sad circumstance because really one is the best solution. So I want to leave you with that now, unless there are some questions. And we'll have a break now until 2, after which we will have Dr. Sullivan talking about veterinary things.
If everybody can get back in their seats, we're going to get started with our featured speaker. Today we are very excited to have Dr. Jamie Sullivan with us to speak. Is everybody ready to get going? All right. Dr. Jamie is originally from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. She received her undergraduate education at the West Virginia University and her doctorate of veterinary medicine from Ohio State University in 2000. Her special interests include exotic animal medicine, ultrasound, and promoting preventative pet health care in the community. She and Dr. Jason share their home with 3 sons, 3 pit bulls, 3 cats, and a Myers parrot and a pond full of koi. So they have quite a menagerie going on. She is from Aloha, and we are very pleased to have Dr. Jason.
The best thing to do is to try to mimic their natural habitat as much as possible. If we can make it as close as possible to what they would have in the wild, you're going to have the healthiest possible tortoise. So, housing. So shelter is important for a number of reasons. One, it reduces stress. Tortoises are not necessarily top of the food chain. So there are certainly things that can come after them. And so if they don't have a place where they can feel that they can be comfortable, that can lead to stress, which ultimately down the road can lead to health issues. Just like people, if you're stressed all the time, you tend to be unhealthier, more susceptible to illnesses, and tortoises, it's the exact same thing with animal species. If they're stressed all the time, it definitely reduces their immune system and makes them more susceptible to disease. Obviously, for safety reasons, we need to have shelter, heat in the summer, cold in the winter, and you know, from predators, and again, from the elements. So they need to have a water container of some sort. It needs to be tip-proof. They do like to tip things over, so you want to make sure that you get something that can be tip-proof and shallow enough if you want to use it for them to soak in, that they can easily enter and exit the dish or pond. You may have a small, shallow pond, things like that. And you want to change the water, clean the water regularly, because they do like to defecate and urinate in the water when they're soaking, so you don't want to leave that out for extended periods. Outdoor housing challenges. Now, this picture that I put up here, it's a picture of what not to do. So a lot of people will go, oh, you know, look, it's got a shady area. They're on the grass. It's protected from prey. It's exceptionally small. You can easily dig out of that. It is not really a protection from heat because, yes, there is a shaded area, but it's certainly not in 115-degree weather going to keep them from getting overheated. So obviously, you probably all have enough experience with tortoises to know what an acceptable environment looks like. And this is just a really good example of a bad environment for tortoises is what not to do. So one of the things that we want to make sure is that because they can climb and they can burrow, that we make sure that the area that they're in, either if you're trying to keep them from coming out of such a certain area, that the walls are high enough or have a lip that they can't crawl over it, because they can get over things. And then you want to extend at least 12 inches below the ground if there's walls or fencing that does not go into the ground, so they don't dig out into your neighbor's yard or come into your, from the neighbor's yard, it sounds like you have. So you want to make sure that it's deep enough that they're not leaving and going into the neighbor's yard or potentially out into the street or someplace like that.
Is that taken here in Las Vegas?
No. And then again, we talked about protection, both from weather and predators. Diet. Again, this talk is pretty much just desert tortoise, and most of the species of tortoises that we see here in Las Vegas that are kept as pets are typically desert species. So their diets are going to be much higher in roughage than you would see like red-footed or yellow-footed tortoises, which are tropical species, which do eat some fruits and other things. So the diets here, we want to definitely make sure that they have, you know, hay or grass is free choice, and those are things that can grow naturally in your yard. The remainder of the diet is going to be made up of mega diets. Ideally, 70% of the diet should be mega diet or, you know, roughage in the yard, things like that. And dark leafy greens you can add as well to give them. The other 20%, you can do a little bit of mixed vegetables, squash, carrots, sweet potato, things like that. And then 10% of, you know, edible flowers or other potential vegetables. The palatable diet should be softened with water. It's one of the ways that they get moisture. They get it through a lot of the plants and stuff that they eat as well. And so adding water to the pellets helps to increase the moisture that they take in. The ingredients generally like to chop, you know, up the greens real well so that they, when they go to get a mouthful, tortoises can be quite picky sometimes about what they eat. I'm sure you guys have experienced that and will pick and choose their favorites. If you chop it well, sometimes they have to kind of eat all of it rather than eating just, you know, their favorite things. Small tortoises, if you don't have a lot to browse in your yard, small tortoises that would feed probably twice a day, but a little in the morning and a little in the evening. If you have a lot of browse in your yard, you probably don't have to feed as readily because then they have other things to choose from. But if they have to rely mainly on you for diet, then I would definitely feed twice a day on the little guys. The medium-sized tortoises you can feed daily, and the large tortoises you do not need to feed daily. You can feed them every other day. So that's one of the nice things about tortoises, is they don't have to eat as, you know, readily. It's not like a dog or a cat. And like Kathy was saying, when you go on vacation, if there is browse in the yard, you do not have to worry about somebody feeding them coming over. So things to avoid. Definitely do not feed them things with animal proteins. It's really bad for the kidneys and can lead to kidney disease later in life. So dog foods, cat foods, monkey chow, human foods. I know that on the internet people find all kinds of things that people say, oh, you should feed it this, you should feed it that. Definitely avoid those things. It's certainly not healthy for them. And then toxic plants. You definitely want to research the plants that are in your yard to make sure that the things that they are eating or have access to are not toxic to them. Some of the common things that we do keep here in Las Vegas, like lilies, rhododendron, heavenly bamboo, lantana, and oleander can be toxic. And I did look up lantana during the break just to see what it was. I couldn't remember the toxicity. With lantana, it actually can cause organ dysfunction, depending on the amount that they get a hold of. And the green berries actually have higher toxic value than the other berries or fruits. And they can be irritating to the skin. The sap or innards of the plant can actually be irritating to the skin. It's not specifically known how toxic they are to tortoises, but they're very toxic to other species of animals, so I would be cautious about it. So. The flowers can be toxic as well. Mostly it was the leaves and the berries had the highest toxicity, but the flowers can also be toxic. And then this is the website that I use when I'm looking for toxicity specifically for tortoises, and it's just the California Turtle and Tortoise Group website, but they have a really good list of poisonous plants and the what causes, what type of toxicity each plant causes. So that's where that came from. So. Hibernation or brumation. Not all species of tortoise hibernate. Again, this is about desert tortoises, but there are species that do not hibernate. So make sure that you know and try to force a species that doesn't hibernate into hibernation is not going to work. So make sure that you research it if you have a different species. Usually starts in October, November, lasts until March or April. There's some important things to know about hibernation. Definitely want to keep their temperatures between 33 and 55 degrees usually, and most burrows will maintain that temperature. The weather outside may get colder, but if there's enough insulation on top of the burrow should stay at an appropriate temperature. If you have to hibernate indoors, and it's not generally recommended, but if for some reason a burrow collapses, something happens, you end up with a tortoise right before hibernation, you don't have a properly set up burrow, you can hibernate inside. It has to be an shed or a garage or someplace where the temperatures will be cool enough. You cannot take them in the house and stick them in a dark closet, stick them under the bed. Those things aren't going to work. They have to have still that same type of temperature range, 35 to 55 degrees. So you're going to have to put them someplace where it's going to, you know, maintain those temperatures. You can use a cardboard box, or I've seen with an insulated cooler to, you know, house them, putting in a separate box inside and then lining between the two with newspaper or things like that to try to help maintain insulation so that the temperature is maintained, and then cover it with something, just a light cloth or things like that. And then this one you can see has where it has both the thermometer going into the box to help maintain and monitor those temperatures to make sure they're staying in correct temperatures. The other thing about indoor hibernation is the humidity is not nearly as good. Outside in the burrow, they have good humidity. The ground will have some moisture to it, so the tortoise will stay more hydrated. Indoors, they're going to get dehydrated much easier, so you will need to take them out every couple of weeks and just do a quick soak, and then put them back in the box for hibernation to maintain that hydration. Otherwise, they can get dehydrated very easily during hibernation. So, not as good an option, but if it's the only option, make sure it's done right. Preparing for hibernation. When these guys do go into hibernation, the weeks, isn't that cute? You don't have to knit them any sweaters. But the weeks before, usually they will slow down their own eating, but you definitely want to fast them for a couple of weeks prior to hibernation. You don't want them to go into hibernation with a gut full of food because it's just going to rot. Their GI tract will slow down during hibernation. They're not going to digest as well, and that food can ferment and start to kind of decompose sitting inside their GI tract, which is not healthy for them. So you definitely want to fast them a couple weeks prior to hibernation if they haven't already done that on their own. Most of the time they do. You also may want to soak your tortoise once per day before this hibernation period, again, just to help beef up their hydration. So unlike Kathy was saying, her tortoise actually uses the pond in those few weeks right before hibernation, which would make sense. I think they're probably, you know, preparing themselves for, you know, the hibernation period, and they're not going to have access to water as much, and so they need to make sure that they're well hydrated before going into hibernation. So if there's any question that your tortoise may not be 100% healthy right before hibernation, do not hibernate your tortoise. I would seek veterinary care, and we may end up not, you know, recommending not hibernating that tortoise that year, depending on, you know, what's going on, or at least trying to get them healthy first. If we have a sick tortoise go into hibernation, again, everything slows down, and that includes the immune system. And if there's infection or things like that, it can run rampant in that tortoise during the hibernation period and may either die during hibernation or come out even, you know, 10 times worse than when they went in. So definitely make sure that your tortoise is healthy prior to hibernation, because we don't want to lose them during that period.
One of the things that happens often is that people get worried about their tortoise right before hibernation, when it's too late to start a course of medication. Would you like to maybe address that?
Yeah, well, and later on I will be addressing, just talking about, well, I can briefly say now that you know, we'll be talking about routine care for tortoises, and one of the things that we do recommend is an annual examination. We usually recommend that kind of end of summer, you know, a month or two before hibernation, just because that way we can make sure that everyone's healthy, there's not any issues. If there's something that maybe just starting, we can cut, you know, head it off early before they, you know, go into hibernation. We make sure they're nice and healthy prior to hibernating. So that's an excellent question, Kathy. And yes, we do recommend annual exams for tortoises, and usually we recommend it, you know, a month or so before that hibernation period, so we can make sure that they're healthy. And if there's anything that needs to be addressed, we have time to address it before they want to hibernate. So when they are in hibernation, I know it's hard with the deep underground burrows to check on your tortoise. And I know that worries people. If you have an above-ground burrow or one where you can see your tortoise, I would check them once a week just to make sure that they look okay. They're going to be sluggish, obviously. That's hibernation. That's what they're supposed to be. But usually they'll respond if you touch their feet, or they'll pull back. They have a little bit of movement. They should be responsive. So if you can't see or reach them during hibernation, just make sure that the burrow is safe and not getting wet. You know, obviously, if it's well-built, it should be fine, but you just want to make sure that, you know, when it's really wet outside, that you're not getting wet in the burrow. So. And then if you can reach them, you may want to, you know, soak them maybe once during hibernation. A lot of tortoises will know if they're getting dehydrated. Like Kathy said, hers comes out and drinks, and even in the winter came out to drink to help maintain its hydration. But you certainly can assist with that. If they're indoors, that has to be done. You're going to have to soak your tortoise during hibernation just because there's not enough moisture there. So. They're going to come out from hibernation in March or April. Temperatures are going to be rising at that point. If you're indoor hibernating, you're going to want to slowly raise the temperatures to about 70 degrees. So again, you're going to have that thermostat in there and slowly increase those temperatures so that it mimics the natural environment as much as possible, and then slowly start to expose them to some light. Once they do come out and start moving around, you may want to soak once a day per week again, because they've been hibernating. Their hydration is probably not as good now as it was in the fall before they went into hibernation. So it just helps to bring up their hydration a little bit, make them as healthy as possible. And it may take them a couple of weeks to start eating, and that's okay. That's not unusual. You know, they're still a little slow. Their GI tract has not fully regained its normal function yet from hibernation, and so it may take a few weeks, and that's okay. And if in a couple of weeks they haven't regained their normal activity or their appetite hasn't started to come around, then you may want to seek veterinary care just to make sure that they didn't have something going into hibernation we weren't aware of and are starting to, you know, come out of hibernation sick. But it does take a couple of weeks to kind of get going. Some routine health care. Well, tortoises don't need a lot of preventive health care. There's not a lot, there's no vaccinations we typically do for tortoises. But we do recommend an annual exam. It helps us to monitor their weight to make sure that, you know, if they're young, they're growing properly, they're gaining weight. You know, discuss nutrition and housing. See if anything's changed at home as far as their environment or, you know, their appetite, you know, what they're eating, what they're not eating, if they're getting picky or finicky. It just helps us to kind of stay in touch with you guys about what your tortoise is and isn't doing, what's normal, what's not normal, what's okay and what's not okay, so we can prevent problems before they happen or even address something if it's starting to develop. So, and then sick reptiles should be seen immediately. Usually when a reptile is sick, if they're showing signs of illness, they've been sick for a little while. Usually they will try to hide it as much as possible, kind of go about the normal routine. They don't want to look sick. The sick animals, when they're a prey animal, get picked off first, and so they try to hide it. So if you're seeing signs that they're not right, then they've probably been sick for a little bit. And the longer that we wait, the much more difficult it is for us to get them back on track. So definitely if they appear to be sick or you have concerns that something's not right, I would make an appointment right away. I'm just going to go through some common things that we see as far as health issues for these guys. And most of them are just pictures. I'm going to talk about them, and if you have questions, please feel free to ask. So, trauma is one of the most common things that we see with these guys, unfortunately. Dog attacks, hit by car, those types of things. And this tortoise here, you can see, it's got its shell chewed on a little bit. This is by far one of the more milder cases of a dog attack. I've seen them come in missing half the shell and half the body, and it can be quite nasty. So they can get along really well with other animals, but you have to make sure that the other animals don't get along well with them. So please be sure if you have dogs or cats or other pets in the yard that either the tortoises have good protection or that the animals are trained well enough to know not to chew on them. So, and then this one actually was run over by a car, and you can see the crack in the shell here. There were several cracks in the shell over here, and this little piece was barely hanging on. So this tortoise unfortunately didn't make it. There was way too much internal damage. So, respiratory disease, another really common one. And I didn't have any tortoise pictures of bubbles from the nose, but here's a greater slide that has bubbles from the nose. They'll sometimes have weepy eyes. They can have puffy eyes. Those are all really common signs of a respiratory disease. You may suddenly notice that their appetite drops off. A lot of times when they're struggling to oxygenate, they don't want to stop to eat. It's kind of like when you have a cold and you're congested and you have to stop breathing to swallow and then you feel out of breath afterwards. They can do this. They have the same thing. And so you may notice that their appetite goes off. So those are very common symptoms of a respiratory disease. Those, you know, are usually fairly easy to treat if we catch it early. If we don't catch it early, we end up with pneumonia, and that's much, much more difficult to treat. You can see this is a normal shell, and the x-ray isn't the prettiest x-ray, but you can see the air up here in the lungs and air sac area here, and that's normal. On this tortoise, you can see how dense it is over here. This tortoise has pneumonia in this left lung lobe here, and so that's much, much more difficult to treat. Once they have a pneumonia, it's 50-50 whether we can get them through that or not, so we definitely want to catch it before it gets to that point. Metabolic bone disease. Metabolic bone disease, unfortunately, I see a lot, and I think it's just because there's not a lot of good education out there. People don't research their pets before they get them, and they don't realize how important natural sunlight is to these guys. Usually I see it in pets that are kept indoors. So desert tortoises, if kept outdoors, shouldn't have this issue, but we can sometimes see it where we'll have, for whatever reason, genetic problems, congenital issues, where they're just not metabolizing calcium properly. But metabolic bone disease is a lack of calcium. They just don't get enough calcium in their system because they can't absorb it through their GI tract for a number of reasons. The most common one is not having natural sunlight or UV light. And so then when that happens, they start to pull calcium from their bones in order to keep heart healthy, muscles moving. Calcium is important for a lot of things. And so then the bones become very weak. The shell becomes very weak. We sometimes get these weird kind of doming scoots on top of the shell. Or in this case, this tortoise squishes. The shell is not hard. The shell is really soft. And the shell is very squishy, and that is not normal. And that's just because it's pulling calcium from the shell and from the bones in order to keep the muscles moving and the heart pumping. And so that's certainly not a healthy way. And it also leads to then down the road, if we correct this issue, they can have some permanent damage. Sometimes we have some shells that then don't grow properly. They can have stunted growth. They can have, you know, long-term kidney issues as a result of that. So definitely it's important for them to get UV light. Natural sunlight is the best way to do that. You know, they really need to be outdoors for the natural sunlight. And if that's the case, then usually they can absorb calcium just fine. And with a mega diet, it's really, you know, well-balanced, so they don't need additional calcium. If for some reason your tortoise will not eat the mega diet, it sounds like the new one is pretty rare. But like I said, tortoises don't always read the books, and they don't know what they're supposed to eat or what they're not supposed to eat. So there'll probably be one out there, I'm sure, that's going to be the exception to the rule and refuse the mega diet. In that case, I would supplement that tortoise with calcium powder just to make sure they're getting enough calcium to prevent this type of disease. So. Shell infections or shell rot we'll see sometimes too. You can see kind of the speckled appearance to the shell here. It almost looks like it's scraping the shell, but it's not. It's flaking off is what's happening. These little bits of shell are flaking off, and they can get infection under the shell there, which will cause the shell to start flaking off. And that's, again, usually pretty easily treated, depending on how aggressive it is. Sometimes we could use a little topical medication if it's just in a focal area. If it's all over the whole shell like this guy's is, we would probably use some oral antibiotics. But again, usually fairly easy to treat, but just knowing what to look for.
Dr. Jamie?
Yes?
Is that started by them scraping the shell?
It does not have to be, no. It doesn't have to be started by scraping. It can. If they scrape the shell, just like if you cut your finger, you potentially could get infection there. So if they're scraping the shell, they could get infection there. But it doesn't have to be. Oftentimes I see them, they're not scraping the shell at all, but they've started to develop this. I think sometimes I'll see it too if there's too much moisture in the environment, because they're not used to that. If the burrow's getting wet or they're, you know, spending a lot of time, there's sprinklers in the area where they're at, things like that. I think excess moisture can also lead to this, make them more prone to shell infections. So, yes.
Would you put peroxide on it?
I wouldn't, no. The best thing to do is actually to dry it out, keep it as dry as possible, and sometimes we'll use an antibiotic ointment on it. Peroxide is okay for cleaning like a dirty wound the first time, just because we want to clean it and get it out, but actually peroxide is toxic to healing and healthy tissue. So I wouldn't use it on this particular case. That's a good question. Intestinal obstructions. You know, one of the things that we worry about is, are they eating gravel or getting into dirt or eating things they shouldn't? And this tortoise was being fed on an area that had gravel and not having a plate or something underneath it. And so it was eating gravel when it was eating, and it has this gravel impaction here where all the gravel is bound up in the intestinal tract. So you have to be careful about things like that too in your environment. You know, watching, is there gravel or rocks in the environment? Is it an area where they're bothering it? Are you feeding them on it? You know, what kind of setup do you have there to try to avoid things like this as well? Bladder stones. We do see bladder stones in tortoises. And this is a huge bladder stone in this tortoise. We just had one the other day that had a bladder stone. And usually we have to do surgery to remove these. We can sometimes do a little incision that's called parafossa, where it's right in front of the back leg and not have to go through the shell. With a stone that's something this large, we would more than likely have to go through the shell in order to take that out. And so we actually have to cut open the bottom of the shell to get in there to do surgery and then put the shell back on and then fiberglass it in place. And once we do that, that damage to the shell remains there for long periods of time. We usually have to continue to fiberglass to keep the shell whole and intact and to prevent, you know, infection or other things to be able to get up into the abdominal cavity there. So.
Is there a new procedure called lithotripsy with the fragments of somebody?
I'm not familiar with that in tortoises. I know people, very common. I don't know if in tortoises it's something that they're doing. It's not something I'm familiar with, but it's not something we have capability of here. I have sometimes been able to, with large ones, break them down once we make the incision through the side, break them down into smaller pieces and get it out without having to do an incision in the shell. But yeah, I don't know about that. So.
I think it's the cost of the equipment.
Yeah, I'm sure that the equipment would be quite expensive. So. At a university level, that may be something that they have available. I would say at most of your general practice veterinarians, that's not going to be an option. So, but I don't even know in town. I know we have a specialty center in town. I think they have to do with that. Yeah. Parasites. We can see parasites in these guys. Ticks are not extremely common in our area, but we do sometimes have ticks. These are ticks on a tortoise here. This is actually an intestinal parasite. It's a nematode. Some parasites in reptiles, like pinworms, are extremely common, generally not pathogenic or cause of disease. Typically don't need to be treated, but these do. This is definitely a type of parasite that would need to be treated. And oftentimes you'll again see anorexia. They may not want to eat. Diarrhea could be a common symptom of this. And so then we would need to address it with the dewormers. Ear abscess. It's not as common in tortoises as they are in turtles, but we do sometimes see it in tortoises. And you can see this bulge right here on the side of this little red-eared slider again on the side of his head. That's actually his ear, but it's abscessed, and so the tissue is bulging out. Normally that would be quite flat. It's bulging out because of the abscess underneath there. So we'll occasionally see that in tortoises, but not as often. So. Reproductive diseases we commonly see in these guys as well. This is the X-rated portion of the talk. So this is the tortoise, the male tortoise with the penile prolapse, and sometimes that will happen just when the breeding season. They're excited. They start, you know, their little penis will pop out, and it'll go back in. No big deal. But occasionally it'll come out and it'll stay out. It'll stay prolapsed, and when that happens, you can see this tissue is quite pink. This is pretty black. This one's been hanging out for a little while. It's gotten dried and irritated, and that tissue has started to become non-viable. And end up having to amputate that. So I know all the guys are good now. They do fine. They live without it. Obviously, it's not ideal, but you know, when it comes to that, you know, that's unfortunately the only way to treat that once it happens. So that does occasionally happen. And then you can get egg binding, where you know, tortoise is about to lay eggs, and for whatever reason can't pass them. Again, with tortoises that have some metabolic bone disease, it's not uncommon for them to have misshapen eggs. And when the eggs are misshapen or softer than normal because they don't have enough calcium to shell those eggs, they can't properly push them out, and so they all get stuck and kind of pile up in there. So then sometimes we can't get those out through that paralumbar incision that I was talking about, the parafossa incision in front of the back leg. Occasionally we will have to open up the shell and go in that way to remove that. This is not eggs actually shelled yet. These are all yolks off of an ovary that is, you know, ready to be shelled, you know, to be passed and to be shelled. So this sometimes we can also see where they're extremely follicularly active on the ovary, and they'll have tons and tons of egg yolks. And if one of those potentially ruptures, they can get a horrible peritonitis in the abdomen from that material. And then anorexia. Anorexia is a common symptom. It's not specifically a disease itself, but I'm sure that probably all of you have experienced at one point or another where your tortoise just doesn't want to eat. You know, it just seems like it's not itself. Appetite is decreased. And sometimes that can be normal depending on the time of season, things like that. But it can be any number of things. Certainly if it persists beyond a week where they're really just not eating, they need to be checked out so we can figure out what's going on. This was a prolonged period of anorexia where it actually ended up getting a feeding tube placed into the neck to try to help feed it in the meantime, but you know, that's not a common thing we have to do. Usually we can solve the source of the anorexia and get them eating again, but it certainly is something that I wanted to bring up because I know commonly that's a concern, is they're not eating, why are they not eating, and you know, generally we have to see them to try to do some tests to figure out what's going on. So. And speaking of tests and things that we can do, so tortoise medicine sounds like it would seem like with that big, thick shell, it can be difficult. There may not be much we can do, but there's actually a fair amount of things that we can do as far as diagnostic testing and medication for tortoises. This is actually given some intraperitoneal fluids where we can actually give fluids into the abdomen. That helps to increase their hydration. We can give some sub-Q fluids too. We just can't give quite as large a volume that way because they don't have as much sub-Q tissue. They don't have a lot of loose skin. There's a little bit in front of the legs, a little bit, in the chest area, but other than that, there's not a whole lot of access to tissue there. So we can place catheters in tortoises. Typically, we use, if they're really sick, what's called an intraosseous catheter, which is actually a catheter into the medullary cavity of the bone. And that gives us really good access to give medications, fluids, things like that. Again, we generally reserve that for really, really sick tortoises because it's not a most pleasant, procedure to place an intraosseous catheter, but it can be done. X-rays we take commonly. That's one of the ways that we, diagnose pneumonia, egg binding, those types of things. We look mainly at X-rays for that. They can be hospitalized. This is a little tortoise in an incubator. So we're keeping the temperatures up, keeping the humidity up, trying to keep that one at its optimal temperature to try to help improve the immune system. Really, when they're sick, it's the most important time to keep their temperature at the right, the body temperatures at the right temperature, because that'll help to stimulate the immune system to keep that going and as healthy as possible to help us out. So. Anesthesia and surgery is something that we also can do for tortoises. Like Kathy was saying, they can hold their breath for a really long time. So typically for anesthesia, we have to use a combination of medications. We use some injectable to induce the anesthesia because if we try to put the little mask on them, they may hold their breath for 2 hours. We're sitting there for 2 hours waiting for them to fall asleep, and they're still, we're all sleeping in the room because the mask is leaking, but they're all completely awake still. So we typically use an injection initially to help stimulate sedation, and then once they're sedated, we can actually intubate them. And you can see this is the opening to the trachea right here at the base of the tongue, and we can easily put a tube down there to help maintain, and then we can put them on the gas anesthetic after that and maintain anesthesia with an intubated tortoise. So. The biggest thing that I preach to people for any exotic species is make sure you have good resources and information, because there's so much misinformation out there, and I would say probably 85% of the sick exotic animals I see, it's just because they've been misinformed or they didn't do the research, and we created the problem. It wasn't that the animal itself was unhealthy, it's we made it unhealthy. So make sure that you have good resources out there. Myself, the other doctors at Aloha Animal Hospital are always happy to answer questions and to try to help you guys out. The tortoise group or other local herpetological societies, journal publications are out there. There's definitely lots of good information, but make sure that you consider the source. So if you're searching on the internet, be careful of who's posted it, because anybody can post anything, and just make sure that it's good information. And if you don't know, ask somebody who is a good resource if it is good information or not. So, any questions? Yes?
What does a normal tortoise poop look like? A healthy poop?
Well, there's going to be a couple of components to a normal tortoise poop. There will be an actual fecal component, which should be usually brown, green. It depends on what they're eating. It will vary sometimes with, by color based on what they're eating, which should be solid. There will be urate, which is from the kidneys, which generally is kind of a whitish to off-whitish color, and then there'll be some water with that. So that would be kind of normal. You don't have to have all three parts every time they go. Sometimes you'll just have urate and water. Sometimes you'll just have some fecal material and water. But it can vary a little bit. And I would say it's kind of like people, not to be gross, but not everybody's going to be exactly the same. Their schedule is not going to be the same, nor is the consistency when they of abdomen when they go. And so you have to kind of learn your tortoise is normal. And when it becomes outside of what's normal for them, then I would be concerned. So, but yeah, those are the normal components of when they go to the bathroom. So,
female desert tortoises that are known to store sperm in 5, 10, 15 years. Mm-hmm. Where are you reproductive tract where you store it, or is there just a lot of all reproductive tract?
No, that's an excellent question. It's not throughout the Female desert tortoises, or female tortoises in general, can store sperm for years and still pass fertile eggs years after they've been exposed to a male. And you want to know where they store that sperm. Is it throughout the entire reproductive tract or in a specific location? It is not throughout the entire reproductive tract. I believe it's in the fallopian tubes is where they store the sperm, but I'm not 100% sure on that, so.
And then the second question is, how do the sperm last that long?
That's a good question, too. They actually have an environment in there that keeps the sperm, both pH is important, as well as temperature, and so they maintain pH and temperature in there, which makes the sperm last. It's also the male tortoise sperm is genetically different than, you know, mammal sperm. The reptile sperm is different in that it can survive that extended period of time. So. Any other questions? Yes?
Do you have any...
That one's hard. You know, tortoises, it is difficult to age them. If we could cut them in half and count the rings, that would be the easiest way, but that's not. There's not a specific way to know exactly how old a tortoise is. We base it usually on size and some characteristics of the shell, but it's still not 100%. I can't tell you, you know, looking at a tortoise, if it's 20 years old or if it's 30 years old. Yeah, I can certainly tell you if it's a really young tortoise, approximately how old it is. But it also can vary because if you don't know their history, we have some that have stunted growth, things that will, you know, affect them young, early on in the growing periods, that can change their growth. And so there's not a specific, really accurate way to know exactly how old a tortoise is. Yes?
Do you know any way for
We can spit a tortoise. Those pictures that I was showing you with the ovaries, essentially when we're going in there, we're spaying a tortoise. We'll take out the ovaries, and we try to do that through the incision in front of the leg, go in and remove the ovaries from the tortoise. We typically only do that if there's been a chronic issue of egg binding. So if we're in there because we have to remove eggs from an egg binding issue, then we'll try to remove the ovaries at the same time. We don't generally prophylactically recommend spaying a tortoise. There's not a good way to neuter a tortoise. So that would be, you know, very difficult. So. There's not a good way, and it's risky to do as a preventative procedure. When we're doing it because they're egg bound or they have a history of egg binding and that is a life threatening condition, then it makes sense to go in and spay them. But in a tortoise that doesn't have any issues, has not had any egg laying issues, it's risky just to do that for preventative when we may not need to. So.
Somebody was trying to tell me the other day that tortoises can withhold egg laying if conditions aren't going to be good for them. Is there truth to that?
There is, yes. You know, if they don't have an adequate spot or they feel that it's not a good place to build a nest, they will try to not egg lay eggs, but that leads to potentially egg binding issues because when they do feel it's time to lay the eggs, they may not be able to. So.
He felt this was environmental. So he had thought it was something to do with global warming and also, I don't know, I can't recall the. I just can't hear.
Yeah, that
is that possibly possible?
I suppose it is possible, yeah, absolutely. I mean, because I don't know what tortoises sense is the ideal environment or not. If they can sense global warming, then maybe that would be, you know, a factor in whether they felt it was a good time to lay eggs or not. I would think more environmentally, like the setup that they're in, their immediate environment, if it is not, if there's not a proper place for them to build a nest or things like that, they may hold off. But typically, they generally try to have a certain time period, but it's not specific, you know, from a time like, you know, people, it's nine months, you know, you get pregnant, 9 months later you have a baby with tortoises, it's not that way. Obviously, they can breed potentially withhold, you know, even having fertilized eggs for years. So it is possible for them once they've had those eggs, it's not an exact period of time when they will lay them, but the longer that they wait after having shelled eggs in the coelom, the more risk it is that they'll have difficulty with actually laying those eggs. So. Yes?
How much does it cost?
Well, it kind of depends on what we're looking for. An examination is usually $50 exotic species at Aloha Animal Hospital. So there are a couple of hospitals in town that will do exotic animals. You have to be cautious. There are some places that say they see exotic animals, but they don't see them on a regular basis. So I'd be cautious about where you go. But at Aloha Animal Hospital, we see them all the time. We have very experienced doctors there. Aloha Animal Hospital. I actually have some cards and some brochures up here, too.
Where are you located?
We're in the southwest, just south of Rainbow at Warm Springs and Torrey Pines, Rainbow on the 215.
I sent him the emails, and they said that when we can talk to Rick, then well, he got a bad habit of wanting to come there all the time at night. So I just want to make sure, like, if he does, if I turn outside during the day, it's okay, or should he just be outside 24/7?
I would try to keep him outside, yeah. But there's a lot of tortoises, like, our own.
He likes to come in at night.
Yeah. He's being spoiled, yes. Yeah. I know. I say our Dr. Cheryl, who works with us, she has a desert tortoise as well, and she does the same thing. She tries to follow the dog in. She says, no. Your place is outside. The dogs are coming. You're supposed to stay outside, but yeah, she'll find her coming and wandering in behind the dogs. So.
Yeah, I think there's no sun at night, but still, you know, I don't want him to go to have
an agent
or anything.
Correct.
He sleeps the whole time, of course.
Yeah, and it's a part of the, you know, part of them. Being outside is that it helps them to maintain their correct temperatures and the cycle throughout the year. And so when it comes time for hibernation, well, it's warm inside, but it's cool outside. Well, really the cool weather is what stimulates their appetite to decrease their, you know, all the changes that they're going through hormonally and everything to prepare for hibernation. If he's coming inside and being really warm at night, he may not go through those changes properly. So it's best to try to keep him outside. So. Yes?
He'll bang on the slider or try to climb up the stucco walls.
They have personality,
like
they're crazy.
Come on,
cut it
out.
So, you may have come to this meeting on for a checkup, say, is that post hibernation or pre hibernation?
I generally recommend pre hibernation. So, if they're, you know, usually we want them to come in about a month or so before normal hibernation time. That way we can just make sure that everything is okay. If there's any questions when they come out of hibernation as to how they're doing, definitely then. Anytime they're just not right, you know, if they're just not eating, you're seeing bubbling from the nose, puffiness of the eyes, shell looks funny, anything that's abnormal, I would have an additional checkup. I usually recommend their wellness exam once a year, usually about a month before hibernation as a kind of a pre-hibernation checkup. So.
When do they usually go into hibernation?
Well, it'll vary a little bit, but October to November time is usually about when we start to see hibernation. So each tortoise is going to be a little bit different. And even within one tortoise, they may not go into hibernation at the exact same time every year. So it depends on the temperatures, the outdoor temperature, things like that, too, that'll affect them. If they have a really hot kind of Indian summer, late fall, it's still really warm, sometimes they'll go into hibernation later than usual. So. Yes?
Situation where our tortoise is pretty good size, probably 12 to 14 inches. And she comes in off of the grass onto the patio, and as this lady said, she'll look into the house and try to come in the door. But we've got an unusual situation. We've got about a 12-inch step between the side driveway and the patio. And if the gate is open, she'll sense an exit. She'll try climbing up this to get out, and sometimes she'll fall over. We have to keep the gate closed, of course, but I mean, when they sense an exit,
yeah. They
put themselves in jeopardy.
Yeah, no, I understand. And yes, that is a, you know, flipping over is certainly a major concern, especially in the really hot summer because they can cook really easily. So, you know, I don't know if there's something you can put there to try to prevent her from trying to climb that spot. Yeah, I don't know if anybody else has suggestions as to far as. You know, what to do to try to prevent them from getting to climbing up.
We always said we should put it like a plywood portion or a barrier going across there, and they show it in one of the brochures there.
Maybe 18 inches high.
Yeah, that may help to make it a little higher so she feels like she can't climb it, so she doesn't attempt to.
We don't have a problem if we keep the gate closed and shoot it open sometimes.
But if they can see outside, they want to
build it there.
She's always searching.
Yeah, we certainly don't want her flipping over in the middle of summer for an extended period of time. That could be fatal. So, got another question.
The upper respiratory disease, is that caused by at least one type of bacteria?
There can be several types of bacteria. Mycoplasma is a real common one, and so you may have heard about mycoplasma as a cause of upper respiratory disease, but it's not the only cause. There are definitely other causes. There are several bacteria that can cause it.
How are those transmitted? I mean, they could be well for months and months, and all of a sudden, is this like airborne, something goes through?
It is. It's, you know, most respiratory viruses, just like in people, are generally airborne. So it can be something that is transmitted from, you know, other tortoises that are not in direct contact. The other thing is that sometimes some of those bacteria are things that are normally in their system, but because of a decrease in immune system, whether it be stress or something else that just caused their immune system to be low, it starts to overgrow and become the problem. So we'll sometimes see respiratory infections, not necessarily that I think they came from something else, or that they obtained it from another animal, as they had that in their system, and then it just became out of control, and their immune system was not able to keep it in check. So,
so how do you treat a runny nose?
You know, typically we, depending on whether it looks like it's viral or bacterial, usually we put them on a course of antibiotics. Most of the time that will take care of it. Depending on whether it's mycoplasma or another bacteria, we may, you know, vary the type of antibiotic that we use.
How do you get antibiotics?
It can be a challenge. Frequently we end up using injectable antibiotics because it's the most reliable way to get a tortoise to take, you know, medication. Getting them to take an oral antibiotic, although some we can, some it's just next to impossible to try to get their mouth open to give them an oral antibiotic, and that's, oral antibiotics have to be given on a daily basis for them. Injectables can be given every other day to every 3 days, and so we usually inject in the front legs, and we teach you guys how to do it most of the time. And if, you know, something that some people are just absolutely uncomfortable with, then, you know, you just bring them in every couple of days and we give them an injection and they go on their merry way. But yeah, most of the time we use injectable because it's just the most reliable way. So. Yeah, no, I don't. We don't pill tortoises, but we do sometimes use some liquid medication. Sometimes we get them to take those. So. Yes.
How do you microchip tortoises?
We can, yeah, absolutely. We do microchipping for tortoises as well, and it's just placed underneath the skin. So we typically do that, and those guys will give them a little pain medication first to microchip them because it's a pretty big needle with the chip. But yeah, they can absolutely be microchipped as well. So.
Might as well ask you, since hopefully it won't happen. If the tortoise turns over like it has, I found it's only in the mouth. I've turned it over and put it in the shade. Is there anything better than that?
You may want to put it in some lukewarm water. Yeah. Obviously, I wouldn't leave it alone. I would watch just to make sure that it's, you know, not sinking underwater or whatever. If it's really stressed and weak, it could aspirate water. If its head goes under, it may not hold its breath and could aspirate. So I would definitely watch that. But I would probably put it in some cool water, you know, like lukewarm cold water. So, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Can a tortoise get constipated?
They can, yeah, actually, they can get constipated. Usually it's a cause of, you know, caused by dehydration. So if their hydration is really good, they shouldn't really have a constipation issue. Occasionally we'll see with parasites too, if they have a really heavy intestinal arm burden, that can cause constipation as well. But you probably won't notice straining. Tortoises don't typically do a lot of straining, but you may notice that it was eating well and there was no fecal material for quite an extended period of time, and then appetite will start to go off if it continues. So. I wouldn't feed fruit. Desert tortoises, like Kathy was saying, are not, you know, geared towards that. They're geared towards roughage, and so their GI tracts are not made to digest that type of food item. So it's not toxic, but it's not comfortable for them when they do eat it. So
the reason I asked, one day when Dino came out, and it was really, really
I'm not sure. It's possible it was constipated. It's possible it just couldn't find a place it wanted to go. It sometimes has some strange behaviors. So. Yes.
On the vegetable side, cucumbers. Tortoise loves cucumbers.
It's not. There's not a whole lot of nutritional value in cucumbers. It's, you know, there is definitely a lot of moisture in it, but there's just not a lot of nutritional value. If you're given a little piece here and there as a treat, it's not going to hurt. But as far as like a good portion of the diet, it's not nutritionally really, it doesn't have much value, so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, leaves are much better. I mean, the dark leafy greens, carrot tops, those types of things, those actually have a lot more nutrients in them than the actual, sometimes the fruit and vegetable itself. So yeah, those are mine. So. And again, all things in moderation. I mean, if that's the only thing they're getting and they're getting tons of it, I would say no, that's probably not appropriate. But if they're getting, you know, mega diet and, you know, roughage and other things, and then you're feeding a variety of greens, absolutely, I think that's fine to include in there. So. Yes.
I have a female South Florida dog, uh-huh. and she has a hook on the end of her tail.
Okay.
Is that something that should be trimmed, or should I just leave that alone?
It's on the end of her tail? Well, it probably should be looked at. I'm not sure. I mean, if it's part of the tail, obviously we don't want to cut that. But if it's growing off the tail, it may be that there's some dead skin or something that did not, you know, wasn't wearing off, and that's how hardened on there.
It's like a end of a tow truck hook.
Huh, weird. No, yeah, we should. I would say it should probably be seen and see if it's something that we should remove or not. But yeah, I'm not 100% sure. I'd have to take a look at it. So. One of the species that doesn't hibernate is sulcatus.
No, they don't.
They do not hibernate, no.
Around your neck, uh-huh. in this area, they've got skin. Is some peeling or some skin, is that normal?
It can be normal to have some kind of shedding of skin there. You know, as they're growing, obviously their skin is changing too, and so we will. Sometimes it's really fine, and so you don't really notice anything. And every once in a while, they'll, for whatever reason, have kind of a big. It almost looks like they're sloughing chunks off. As long as the skin underneath looks normal, I'm not too worried about it. If it's something that's happening, it seems unusual, or there's any redness or irritation, swelling, anything that else, I would have it checked out. But it is occasionally normal for them to kind of have, you know, pieces of skin kind of peel off, and there's new healthy skin underneath it. It just, for whatever reason, the dead skin didn't come off in little pieces as they grew, and then they got this big piece that now starts to peel off. So.
Yeah, I like to be scratched.
I had my kind of client that had a torso loved its butt scratch. She would scratch its, you know, the base of its shell and stick its butt up. I'm like, who knew tortoises like their butt scratched? So.
Well, I'll go home and try it.
Yeah.
Well, there's kind of a huge variety of peas. I mean, he eats a lot of dandelion greens.
Uh-huh.
But I mix it sometimes in the mulch and he'll eat it, but sometimes he won't.
Okay.
So I don't know, like, what's another good, like, vegetable mix or, like, what's, like, a standard thing that you'll eat.
Yeah, I mean, if it's not on mega diet, I would certainly try adding mega diet. But then, you know, you could, you know, as far as greens, dark leafy things.
All the time, that's on
the
herbs. They say they'll mix it up, you know,
it seems like, well, if he's on, and like I said, if they're on mega diet, which is a completely balanced diet, then if he's really picky or finicky about the other things, I'm not as concerned about it because he's getting all the nutrients that he needs in that particular.
He'll eat more greens, and I'm just trying to, like, kind of hide it in there more,
uh-huh.
like, mixing it up to, like,
how big a tortoise is he?
It's about that big.
About that big. Well, you know, and then he probably doesn't even need to have it every day if it's that size. But I would probably feed him, I don't know, I'd probably feed him like a quarter of a, or eighth of a cup or a quarter of a cup of mega diet a couple times a week. So, yeah, I would think that that should be good enough. And then if you're getting to eat other things in between, even if it's very few other things, at least you're, you know, he's getting a balanced diet. If they weren't eating a mega diet, I'd be much more concerned about, you know, him being picky and only eating one type of grain. But if they're eating a mega diet, they're already getting a really balanced diet, and that other stuff is just supplements.
I love spurge, purslane, mulberry leaves, dandelions. There's some funny light colored weed that comes up. Do you like that? I go around and leave my garden into a big tray and then take it back. So
mm-hmm.
I go, oh, touch. Mm-hmm. Hauling ass out when I open the gate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and there's the variety of different things. A lot of things that we consider weeds, they think are, you know, delicacies.
Oh, so. Weeds. I pull it out of a rose pot. Is there any problem with those?
Not that I can think of. Obviously, the one you don't know what it is, so I can't tell you for sure whether it's. But most of the time, horses will, if there's a lot of abundance of food available, they will avoid things that don't make me, that are not good for them, or that will make them feel ill. So if they're.
I've got a couple of weeks that I pulled and taken back there. They left them, so I stopped eating them.
The internet.
It's like my little great-grandson laying there.
Yeah, I got that off the internet, actually.
Well, it says Marie Kane.
Yeah, there you go. That's right.
What is it?
Marie Kane from Auburn.
I did a search for cute little pictures that didn't have like the tortoises with the crocheted little dinosaur outfits on. I found that on the internet too. So. There are some good things on the internet. Anything else?
Do you recommend anything for tick prevention?
I don't here. We don't have a huge tick problem. It's not a major concern for most of the valley, so I don't typically recommend anything for tick prevention. If we're in an area where it was a huge problem, there are some products that you can use. You can use Frontline on reptiles. I would probably more treat the yard with Frontline than I would the tortoise to try to prevent ticks from being in the environment in that location rather than directly on the tortoise. But because we don't have a huge problem here, I figure why if it ain't broken, we'll fix it. So.
The cucumber leaves we talked about, they're kind of rough and spiny. Mm-hmm. And they swallow them okay?
Yeah, so are cactus and they like that stuff too. So yeah, it should be fine. They have a real firm plates inside the mouth, and the GI tract is usually not sensitive to that kind of thing. So
I kept mine from eating them because I if they could swallow them or
no, it should be fine. You know, it should be fine for them. That shouldn't be a major issue for them. So. Yeah, make sure you wash them really well. Either buy organic or use a vegetable soap to rinse them, and make sure that there's no pesticides on them. But yeah. Anything else? Yes.
My neighbor has a bad red ant problem.
Okay.
And they're starting to climb over the block wall. And I've been using I found a non-toxic way on the internet to kill them. But I'm wondering if they should start nesting in my yard. Is there a way? I mean, will they just attack my turtle, basically, is what I'm wondering.
They can. If you get a really nasty problem or your tortoise gets sick or something like that, they can go after it. Most of the time, there's not a huge problem with that. They have pretty thick skin, but they certainly up in the shell areas can have sensitive areas of skin. So if they started, developing nests or a real problem in your yard, I would consult it. An exterminator, or they can use insect growth regulator type products because they affect the things in insects that mammals and reptiles don't have, and so they're not toxic to mammals and reptiles. So I would definitely stick with those types of products that are insect growth regulating products because then they should be very safe. So. Thank you so much for inviting me. I appreciate it.
We say we're here 1 to 3, and there it is. We're perfect today.